I see that the attendees are coming in, and we have everyone ready. So I think we will just kick off. It is 11 o'clock. So hello, everyone. Thank you very much for joining. My name is Jens Schröder. I am a Just Transition Policy Officer working at the Bankwatch Brussels office, and I'm going to moderate this session today. So just for information, Bankwatch will be hosting monthly webinars on the last Monday of the month, all the way throughout 2023. And we are hosting this first one in the series just a month after the final deadline for submitting TJTPs and the end of the programming phase of the just transition process in the EU. So it's a perfect time to zoom out, look back at the process, both the good and the bad practices, and to extract as much learning from it as we can as we move into the implementation phase. So I'm very glad to see that so many of you have tuned in today, and we hope to make it worth your while. And to that end, we also have some really excellent panelists and presenters with us today. So just to lay out the modalities, we're going to start with a presentation from my colleague, Dr. Miłosława Stępień, who is going to lay out the current state of play on the just transition process in Central and Eastern Europe. And then afterwards, we're going to open the floor for a conversation between our three panelists, who are Mr. Sander Happartz, Policy Coordinator for the Just Transition Fund at the Commission's DG Regio, and Mr. Ivan Sergeyev, Just Transition Process Coordinator at the Estonian Ministry of Finance. And finally, Mr. Stefan Krastev, who is Deputy Mayor of Pernik, which is a city in the coal region of Pernik in Bulgaria. So I think without any further ado, I'm going to leave the floor to Dr. Miłosława Stępień.
Hi, and welcome. It's really great to see you today and to talk a little bit about where we are with the Just Transition. I think it's going to be a very exciting year because after 2 years of planning what to do with the money that was supposed to come in, finally, we're at the stage where we have approvals of at least the majority of the plans, and we are beginning the implementation stage. So we are going to be talking and observing where the money is going. So just to give a general overview also to those people who don't know a lot about Just Transition, some background information. So the Just Transition concept is much broader term, which basically was introduced by, first of all, the labor movements, for example, in North America in the 1990s. Where there were transition movements away from heavy industry. But what happened a lot of the times was, as we know, these industries would collapse and the people who had been involved in these industries would completely disappear from the labor markets. The unemployment rates in these regions would grow exponentially. And basically this would mean an economic and social collapse in these regions. And so now when we started talking about the European Green Deal, what happened was the labor movements in Europe started talking about a just transition and a just transition fund that in majority was aimed to support the people that were going to be impacted by this transformation of heavy industry and high emitting industries. So this is where the idea of leaving no one behind sort of appeared, but this has grown into a much wider term. So we have a very specific fund, the Just Transition Fund, but it does not only address at this moment the issues of people who are losing their jobs in the heavy industries, but is a much wider term which talks also about, I don't know, economic redevelopment, economic diversification, so finding new ways of developing regions. And also it is very much focused on sort of providing the basis for this environmental and ecological transformation. So it has a lot more elements than it was initially planned to. It also has a very important gender element, at least in how it's written. We'll see how it goes phase, and a youth aspect. Why these two elements are important is because it's been noted that in such transformations of heavy industry areas, frequently women are very hard impacted by such changes, even though they were not directly usually employed within the sectors. And the second group that was frequently left out of the conversation, but also heavily impacted, are young people who frequently decide to leave such areas. So we've heard, of course, of these issue of brain drain. So these are two specific groups of society that have been also targeted by the regulations. So this regulation is in force since 2021, and it applies to the funding period 2021-2027. So as you can all probably note, we're already in 2023 and we haven't even begun spending the money. The money will be spent this year. And this is because the just transition process involved a very, very developed planning procedure, about which I think Sander can tell us more, because he was very much involved in approving the plans that were developed in the different territories. Another important aspect of this whole process is that it's territorial. So it's focused on specific regions in the European Union that have been identified as regions that will undergo an extensive transformation from coal mining or coal firing, from oil shale, from peat, and also from, I skipped something, but I can't remember. So generally carbon intensive also industries. The programming period was basically, so the programming period was this period during which these plans were created for the regions. And these plans were supposed to give a vision of how the funds would be spent. And this was done in 2021, 2022. It has just been completed in December 2022, and right now we're in the implementation phase. And generally, throughout the European Union, there will be about 19.2 billion euro provided to these regions so that they can make sure that no one is left behind during this transformation process. So as I mentioned, there here we have a wonderful map from the Just Transition Platform website. It's an interactive map. So this is a map where you can check what regions throughout Europe have applied for the Just Transition Plan, and which of them we followed the site to see which of them were approved in the different periods. So this is something you can also have a look at for yourself, which also sends you off to the plans, the pages with the plans of the different countries. So you can also find them through this website. So generally, the whole of last year was this process of approvals. And towards the end of the year, there was gradual sort of developments in this area. And the first of the countries that Bankwatch works on, because we work on Central and Eastern Europe, the first of our countries to have its plan approved was actually the Czech Republic, which was in September. In October, we had Estonia, November, Slovakia, and then we had a whole bunch of countries being approved in December. For us, the ones of interest were Latvia, Poland, Romania, Hungary. But as you can see, the Just Transition Fund also applies to a lot of countries in Southern Europe, Western Europe, and Northern Europe. So the ones in green are the ones that have been approved. We have invited today two representatives of two countries. So Estonia, which is provide an example of probably one of the best planning processes. We'll see how the implementing process goes. I think Ivan can tell us more. Estonia, as you can see, was approved in October. This is, it has one just transition region, which is Ida-Viruma, an oil shale region in the northeastern part of Estonia. But I'm sure Ivan can tell us more about this. And the second country that we chose was Bulgaria, in which We know of the extensive participation of local and regional participants, of which Stefan Krastev is a great example. I've met him repeatedly during Just Transition Platform meetings in Brussels, and we've talked extensively about the issues that his region and the other two regions in Bulgaria are having. So the regional, I would say, willingness to go through the transition is very high, but unfortunately, because of the difficult political situation in Bulgaria, at the moment, Bulgaria has not had its plans confirmed. The government actually backed out of the confirmation, and we are unsure whether in the coming months Bulgaria will receive the Just Transition Fund, while the regions themselves are really very, very much focused on wanting to have these funds. So here we have an overview. Like I mentioned, with Bulgaria, we have three just transition regions. These are all coal regions. We have Pernik, of which Stefan Krastev is a representative, Stara Zagora, and Kyustendil. The most important issue, which is sort of blocking our national issues with governance linked to political instability for the last 3 years, where there have been repeated parliamentary elections basically every half a year for the last 3 years. So this has led to a lot of issues with the just transition process. And I think it'll be interesting to see these two extremes. Now, some key concerns and recommendations that we as Bankwatch have for the implementation phase. So during the previous years, we were looking mostly at the planning phase and impacting the planning phase, making sure that a lot of different stakeholders were involved and there was high participation in this planning stage, and that also the quality of the planning was as high as possible. But right now we're entering this implementation phase where countries will be choosing projects, and we have a lot of concerns at the moment. One of the biggest concerns we have is the risk of low absorption rates. So what does this mean? It basically means that we are worried because the part of the just transition funds, about 57% of the just transition funds, have to be contracted by the end of this year. And this means that a large part of the projects have to be ready by the, I would say, by early autumn, in order to make sure that they are contracted. And if this isn't done, the money will not be possible, it will not be possible to use this money. While what we're seeing on the ground is that a lot of the regions are not ready, they do not have enough projects ready in order to make sure that enough enough projects are implemented or contracted by the end of the year. So because of these short deadlines linked to the next generation EU funds, this will mean that the largest projects will probably be the easiest and the fastest to fund. So one of the dangers we're seeing is that large enterprises that have the funds to get people to write the projects the way they should be written will be receiving a lot of the JT funds, but we'll see how this develops over the course of this year. An important link with this is that basically a result of this, or something that would need to be fixed in order to counter it, would be the building of capacity and technical assistance for the regions, because it goes without saying that these regions are frequently not prepared for such a process. It is actually quite an innovative process in many ways. But these are frequently regions that have high migration rates, brain drain, low administrative capacity, because they're frequently not the capitals of their regions. This means that they require more people, more experts to come in and to support them. There also needs to be a very high level of focus on making sure that all these different stakeholders that were involved in the planning will also participate in the implementation phase, so that they will also have an impact on what kind of projects are chosen and how the project selection criteria is created. Another key concern that we have, so this was basically what we have seen linked with, you know, readiness of the regions for absorbing the funds. And I think I saw a question, so I'll go ahead and let you ask before I move on further.
We'll just collect the questions at the end. I think that's going to be a lot
easier. Okay. All right. Okay. So the second part sort of our concerns is linked to a more general situation. So one of the big worries for NGOs that are dealing with this issue is the risk of backlash. So this is especially true if we don't see the transformation happening as it should in the regions. This might signify that there will be backlash. So this is especially true of regions which are going through very quick transitions. One such example is Eastern Wielkopolska, where basically the last lignite mine after over 70 years of lignite mining will be closed in 2024, so next year. People are losing their jobs. I had some surprising conversations last week, because despite the announcements that the Just Transition Fund would be coming in, a lot of people still didn't believe that they were already approved and that they were coming in, because the process is prolonged. So they're not actually seeing any sort of real results yet. And this will might cause a backlash, especially if the projects are not do not really answer the needs of the region. So this is something that needs to be monitored over the next months. Another sort of backlash that might erupt is the energy crisis and inflation issues. So because energy prices are rising, because the inflation in some countries is really, really extensive, we are seeing also a backlash against the transition process. And the only way to really answer that is to make sure that the energy prices drop as a result of the transition. And then, of course, what is linked to this is the risk of backtracking on climate ambitions. I mean, this is a separate sort of issue, and I'm not going to talk about how we can reply to this. I'm going to focus more on this first part, so the absorption. So some of the recommendations that we have is to make sure that civil society, but also regional managing authorities or regional managing authorities of towns or things like that, that participated in the planning process are also involved in the monitoring committees. So we need all these stakeholders that did things on the regional level then to also be taken into account when the money is being spent or planned for spending. Over the course of this next year, there needs to be a lot of focus on capacity building and bringing in experts to support people at the regional level so that these projects are created, selected, and implemented as they should be. We've had a lot of exchanges over the last year with DG Regio about targeted and tailored technical assistance for smaller stakeholders. And I think it would be interesting, Sander, to hear from you about the new technical assistance if you want to already talk about it. There needs to be space for community-led projects. I think this is also because we need to remember that it's not enough to answer the issues that the larger enterprises are talking about, but there needs to be a focus on these smaller social issues, because otherwise the risk of backlash will really grow. And keeping ambition high despite this backlash, energy crisis, and backtracking is really, really a huge focus for the next months. So that's a very general overview. I hope it gives a good basis for the rest of the conversation. And I'm going to hand over back to you, Jens. And thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thanks a lot, Milka. I think that was an excellent way to sort of frame the discussion and, you know, prepare for an illuminating discussion afterwards as well. So now I want to ask a question to the panelists, and I'm thinking that it makes the most sense to have responses first from the two sort of country representatives we have with us, and then moving to the commission. So essentially, what I want to ask is, what would you say has been your key takeaways from the programming phase? And is there anything you would have done differently, knowing what you know now? And also, an extension of that, is there any learning that you take from the programming phase that will, you know, impact on the next phase, something you learned during programming that you take with you into implementation specifically? So I'm thinking maybe we can start with Mr. Krastev. Stefan, if you would like to answer.
Thank you so much, really. Well, for us, especially as Pernik municipality, the programming phase really went really well because we took, our active role in it, because we've always, preached that we'd like to be a subject of the change and transition, not an object of the change and transition. One thing that struck me during the programming phase, and it is something that Miroslava also touched on in her presentation, is the broad spectrum of stakeholders that you don't necessarily see at first sight, but have got actually things in common with just transition, or will be influenced by the just transition that is about to happen. I'll give you just an example, the young people that are from our town, the people who are in energy poverty, and so on and so on. So I think this is a lesson learned. And I think that in the implementation phase, the broader spectrum of stakeholder gets attracted, then the more successful it is going to be. And also, one other thing that I took from the programming phase personally is that, once again, I'd like to say, in some of the regions in Bulgaria, the people are still more or less holding on to the thought that, coal mining and the usage of coal for energy production will continue forever. In Pernik, where industrial coal mining started in Bulgaria more than 130 years ago, we are very much realistic and we look forward to the change happening. And because of our delay in the just transition plans being approved, due to the political instability in Bulgaria in the past few years and the frequent changes of governments and the cycle of elections, we have started working towards achieving our goals for climate neutrality and for low carbon footprint using other means and other funds and other projects. We're about to have a zero carbon strategy being produced later this year, financed by the financial mechanism of the European Economic Area. And we're also working on like small pilot projects. For example, taking a specific school and bringing it away from the district heating system powered with coal, but converting it to completely renewables. So this is one key takeaway, I think, for the programming phase as well. The Just Transition Fund and the Just Transition Mechanism are there for us to use, of course, and we should make the best of them. But if there's any, hindrances, if there's any hiccups, or if there is something that we'd like to do earlier or something that we'd like to broaden, then we shouldn't stop looking for alternative opportunities to complement and to build on the opportunities that the Just Transition Fund gives us, if that makes sense. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Ivan, would you also like to have a say here?
Yes, gladly. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Both the audience and the fellow speakers. Hi, nice to see everyone. So I think it's the same for us. If we speak about the programming phase, then it's really been great. We started somewhat early in early 2020. We started off with like very extensive partnership right away. We've held that as one of our paramount values throughout the programming process. So the programming is, programming is always fun. You try to envision the future, you try to, be creative, you try to reach out to people. Of course, if you have time and if it's something that you do, thankfully in Estonia, this participatory democracy is something that we value. And it's pretty easy to organize being a tiny country, right? But now I think we're in a really critical phase, honestly, of like the start of implementation. So I was looking at the slide that Miroslava you showed, and I was like, yep, like agreed. You know, and the situation, and I mean, I think the two important factors are, well, the first of all, the environment that we're currently operating in, right? So there is a war in Ukraine, there is an energy crisis, there is a, I don't know, there is inflation, you know, that the like the markets are basically kind of winding down with the rise of the what do you call them, the interest rates and so on and so forth. So we're kind of in a situation where we're having it's pretty turbulent. And if we consider that one of the major points of the JTF2 is to invest into new jobs, new jobs come with investments by companies. And if the companies have trouble, let's say, getting financing or they see trouble seeing themselves in the future in anything that they do because of the, you know, the current economic situation, then it's very difficult to implement the fund and be like, hey, guys, we have money to give you, just make jobs. You know, they're like, we're trying to survive. We're not trying to make any new jobs. So it's a very tough time to make investments into anything. That's one thing that we should be really kind of clear about, I think. And it's an objective reality. It's not something that is tough only here in Idaviruma. Yes, we're right on the border with Russia. So, I mean, for us, it's especially fun. Not really, but you know what I mean. But it's kind of true all over Europe. We're facing pretty difficult times. That's one thing. And the other thing is that this is really the first time we're trying to do this. Like, Just Transition Fund is a completely new fund. We've never done this before. We're just now, you know, we are running late with things because the frameworks are just being established on the go. Again, because we're doing a new thing. And it's a great new thing. I mean, we're trying to establish sort of a best practice for the rest of the world to follow in the next 30 years or so, you know, as the countries roll onto the climate neutrality goals that they've established for themselves. So I think we're here and we're just facing some of the pain of the first, let's say, the trailblazers. And we just need to be aware of that, you know, and the countries are trying their best to implement the funds with the as much flexibility, as much speed as possible. I mean, the commission is trying, I hope, Sander, that the commission is trying to be flexible with how it approaches and kind of looks at the different situations on the ground. And I think we should just keep it that way. Understand that it's a very challenging situation. This is the first time we're doing this. And just communication is key between the European Commission and the countries involved, between the different stakeholders. And also flexibility and agility, I think, are extremely important in cases like this. So that, I think that would be my 2 cents. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And yeah, it's a very good point that, you know, Just Transition is a tall ask. And this trailblazing part of it is really going to be key in the future. So Sandra, I would really like to hear your thoughts on this as well.
Yes, thank you very much. And I'm happy to see so many people listening to this webinar and interested to hear the experiences from Bulgaria and Estonia. So looking back on what we did, a couple of perspectives from the Commission. I think it's important to remember that the JTF was proposed as part of the European Green Deal at the time when we were already preparing with member states the next MFF. So it came in the middle of this new process. It came a bit later to the table than the other funds. And this was, of course, challenging. Even more challenging was that then shortly afterwards, of course, the corona pandemic broke out. And as part of the Commission's reply, there was the Next Generation EU instrument, which added money to the Just Transition Fund, which was, of course, very good. But it also came with a more limited time frame, the Next Generation EU money, which Miloslava already referred to. Although I have to make a small precision with regard to this time frame, but this I can come back to later. The Just Transition Fund was also challenging in terms, I mean, more challenging, you could say, than the other cohesion policy funds for other reasons. And one of the main reasons was that, in fact, the territorial scope of the fund was not predefined. It was part of the programming negotiations with member states. And this made, of course, these programming negotiations much more complex than for instance, the Cohesion Fund or the European Regional Development Fund, where the decision on how much money goes to each region is taken before the programming negotiations, because it's done at the level of the regulation. So for the JTF, we needed not only to discuss what the JTF will do, but also which regions it would go to. For some cases like Estonia, this was quite uncontroversial and clear from the outset, but for other cases, this was really a very important part of the negotiations as such. There were also other differences with regard to what the JTF could fund. So for instance, these productive investments in large enterprises, which we will fund with the JTF in under very strict conditions. This is something that we is true for investments to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from ETS activities. All this was very new, not only for the member states, but also for the Commission. So this made the programming of the fund much more challenging, much more complex. Often I felt that I was playing three-dimensional chess when doing this. And then lastly, the TJTPs as such, because of course, on top of the programs, we had these plans, the territorial just transition plans, where in fact the intervention of the JTF in each region was linked to certain commitments that were at national level and then with their impact at regional level. So all of this made it quite challenging. But I have to say that it now, you know, we are done. So as was said before, we actually adopted all the TJTPs that were submitted to us. So not a majority, but all that were submitted, because Bulgaria decided not to submit formally any TJTPs. We are hoping, of course, to see them very, very soon. But all of this also has a positive outcome. So the fact that we worked much more intensively on the programming of this fund, the fact that we now have these plans, in many cases, they already identify concrete projects. This is a step ahead of the other funds in several cases. So as soon as the implementation of the JTF starts, we already have more concrete plans in several member states and regions than we are used to with the other cohesion policy funds. The fact that the deadlines are shorter, or at least for a large part of the money, the deadlines are shorter, it also pushes us and the regions to start implementing much sooner than they are used to with the other cohesion policy funds. This means that we have a huge opportunity in Europe to show how this fund, this new fund, but also cohesion policy as a whole, how it can deliver really on its ambitions before the end of the period. And this is something that will shape the future of cohesion policy as well. So really, this is a key priority for DG Regio, for the European Commission, the implementation of the JTF this year and the next years, because the future of cohesion policy depends on it. And many of the regions have benefited for decades from cohesion policy. Now we need their help as well to show that they can deliver early on with the Just Transition Fund. The fact that the intervention is linked to these commitments is also, I think, an advantage that we have. And I understand and I count on organizations like Bankwatch to keep us on our toes about this. But the truth is that formally speaking, there is no backtracking yet. So we have no indications from any of the member states. I am now not talking about Bulgaria, of course, but for all the others, we have zero indications, formal indications that they would be backtracking towards their commitments. I was in Western Macedonia, in Greece last week. There was a minister there as well who said literally our timeline is not put into question. And this is still officially speaking the case for all of our JTF regions. So what I also see is that there is now a lot of opportunity, a lot of enthusiasm. I see it today here as well to do something useful and do something meaningful with the Just Transition Fund. We will stay close to member states and regions, and I can get back to that later as well if you would like. And then to close on your question, we will of course evaluate what we are doing and what we have been doing, but also on the implementation. There will be a report on the outcome of the negotiations of the program negotiations. This will come out in a couple of months or weeks. And then, of course, we will monitor the implementation, we will evaluate, and we will draw lessons for the future, and we will keep you updated on that as well. If I can perhaps just specify these deadlines. So the Next Generation EU funds, which are 57% of the JTF, they needed to be committed before the end of 2023. But this commitment is done. So it is by adopting the programs that these financial commitments are done by the Commission. What is now the real deadline is that all of the funds need to be spent. They are put into different annual tranches, and all of these tranches need to be spent 3 years after the commitment of that year. And the thing with the Next Generation EU money is that all of this money is put into the 2022 and 2023 tranches. And this means that more or less 35% of the whole JTF needs to be spent by the end of 2025 and another 35% by the end of 2026. This is what these deadlines mean. There is no legal deadline to contract. There is a legal deadline now only to spend, and 35% of the money needs to be fully spent by end of 2025 and another 35% by the end of 2026. And the rest, so the other 30%, this is only MFF money, so not Next Generation EU money, is in the 2024, 5, 6, and 7 tranches. And each of them also needs to be spent 3 years after. So this is to specify, but perhaps we are going now into too much technical details. I think the point is that 70% of the money needs to be spent by the end of 2026. And of course, all the conclusions that you draw with regard to early planning, efficient planning, these are all very, very true.
Thank you very much, Sandra, for that very useful intervention. I see we have a comment now from Miłosława. So please go ahead.
It's not really a comment. I think it's very interesting what you're saying, Sandra. I mean, we've been sort of trying to touch on this issue of the commitment or contracting of the different funds for a year now. And I would love to come back to this question because, I mean, this is what we're hearing on the ground from the managing authorities that they're worried about. And I think... for them, it's also, it was until recently at least, unclear. So maybe this is something that needs to be sort of explained more broadly to the different managing authorities so that they know specifically what kind of funding they, what parts of the funding they need to spend by when. And I agree with what I think Ivan mentioned, you know, the novelty of this process, and in many ways, the fact that some of the frames were sort of made along the way has led to a lot of uncertainty in how certain things should be done. Also frequently because the managing authorities that are doing this are not always ones that have experience with the previous funding horizon. So I think this is one of the issues, but it's great to hear what you're saying, Sander, about them having a bit more leeway in terms of spending the money and fund absorption. So I will hand back to Jens.
Yes, thank you very much. And I think it's very useful to know, like, look back a little bit at how the process has been going to try to extract the learning from it. But I'm also very interested in learning about, you know, the way ahead. So I was thinking maybe we could do a round of the countries just outlining sort of the key priorities and the plans that you have, maybe some interesting projects, developments in Bulgaria. And then also to get some insights from the Commission on how they see the implementation moving forward. So, Stefan, would you like to comment a little bit about the process in Bulgaria?
Sure, of course. Well, in the moment with the forthcoming elections in April, yeah, it's what also the representative of the Commission mentioned, that there was indications given for backtracking. However, in my opinion, at least, you know, a contract is valid until it's changed. And for the moment, between the state of Bulgaria and the European Commission, no new, you know, things have been negotiated. So at least according to us at the local level, we'll carry on forward, and we're expecting at the end of first quarter one of this year, to have the territorial just transition plans submitted to the Commission. For our region, we have we have tried to be very realistic with what we're going to do with the just transition funds. The funds are mostly dedicated to economic diversification and the development of our industrial zone, with the target of attracting, enterprises from the circular economy sector. I'm very happy to announce that we have already the first, investment interest from, an enterprise that wants to do here a production line for assembling solar panels in combination with thermal pump systems. Even in some of our vocational high schools, from this year, we already have a class of students studying renewable energies. So the main focus will be on economic diversification and, of course, retraining of staff. But I must say once again, in Pernik, the transition from coal mining happened more or less organically throughout the years. We have very limited mining activity at the moment. So it's not such a huge target group of people that will need to be retrained. We're talking about several thousand people here. These are the two main directions in which we're going with the Just Transition Fund. But as I said, our expectation and what we've heard as an indication is that the Just Transition plans will be submitted to the Commission at end of quarter one. This is at least the information I have. And actually the biggest issue here, the reason why there is backtracking and so on, is not so much, apart from the elections, is not so much our region and the neighboring region of Kyustendil and Bogomdol. The problem lays in Stara Zagora. And to be perfectly honest with you, as a representative of the region of Pernik, at the moment, I feel we are suffering for reasons that are beyond us and that we're not responsible for. And so if this continues, we will most likely raise the question of, splitting the territory of just transition plans and just, probably approving them region by region. So at least the regions and the people who are ready to move on can move on and get on with it. In a nutshell, this is our expectations for the forthcoming months.
Thank you very much, Stefan. And I hope Sandra is noting down so we can answer. But we will leave the floor first to Ivan.
So, and the question is how we're doing currently, as far as I understand, correct?
Yes.
Go ahead, John.
Just key priorities and tidbits about your plans for the implementation phase. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, so our... the territorial just transition plan was adopted in October last year. It was really great that the president of the European Commission came to visit Itä-Virumaa, the target region of the JTF, because it really sent a very clear, being on the border of NATO and being on the border with Russia, Itä-Virumaa is located in a very important geopolitically very important place. So having the president of the European Commission come and visit us and say, you guys are not going to be left behind with the JTF or anything else, was really a very important message to be sent. So that was, I think the local community appreciated it a lot and gave the JTF a whole different level of kind of seriousness as to this is not just something that we've been planning for 2 years, but this is like if the European Commission's president comes and kind of launches this, then it must be serious. So that was really great that the Commission found an opportunity to do that. I think it sent the right message. But as far as what we're doing now, essentially there is currently what we're working on the most is developing the different interventions, right? So our plan foresaw over 10 different interventions. So some of them are meant for example, the research and development activities. Some of them are meant for providing new jobs. Some of the investments are going to be made into the social infrastructure. So there are like these different tracks. And so what we're doing now is we're developing these tracks, developing the different, bylaws that would be governing those tracks, and so on. So that's the major effort right now, making sure that the interventions, not just the plan, but the interventions actually work. We also do have one intervention that is already in force. It was actually kicked into gear already last year. And we also have our first investments as well, which is now public. It's an investment into magnets in the JTF territory. And it's kind of a big deal because magnets obviously comprise a very important, it's a very important part of the, let's say, the green economy. You know, half of the things that will be moving by 2050 are going to be moving partially due to the fact that we have magnets. And it's something that has been dominated so far by China. Like it's this industry specifically, like the rare earth metals and magnets. And so this is very important for us that here in Itaviruma, in the JTF territory, we have an establishment of a manufacturing plant that is not only going to provide jobs for the local community, but it kind of makes a very important statement for the future of the development of the industrial complex of Europe as a whole. So it was a major news for us. We're really happy that the company chose Itaviruma specifically to be establish a facility there. But there are more to come. And there are a few in the pipeline right now as well. So yeah, but overall, the main thing is just developing the interventions. But another important aspect that a lot of my personal time goes to is communicating the just transition. Because as we know that the JTF usually takes place, like the just transition plans are implemented in territories that are not necessarily the most climate policy aware or supportive. In that sense, like with the JTF again, there is this message that this is something new. This is something that is done in a very complex situation, like in a region. Basically, you have to explain why JTF is good. A lot of times it's perceived as something that the European Union gave us, like a little money that is worth virtually nothing. Like the whole oil shale industry gives you the same amount of money in 2 years in tax that the whole JTF amounts to for the whole period. So this is an argument I hear a lot. And so it's very easy to kind of, to downplay the importance of the JTF. And that's why it's a constant effort to be explaining to people why we're doing this. Why are we pursuing these national targets? Why is it this territory that needs to, you know, suffer the most? Why do we have to change jobs? How do you get training opportunities? Why do you even have to get training opportunities after you've been working in the oil shale sector for 25 plus years? So things like this, you know, it's very important to keep the community on board constantly with this whole thing. I mean, for us, it was a great news that the JTF, our JTF plans were, you know, adopted by the European Commission, but a lot of people are like, yeah, I can't see anything. Like, what are you talking about? So this is kind of a very important aspect to keep in mind, that the community needs to be on board. And that's not just because it sounds great that the community needs to be on board, but really the JTF, like about the speed and the effectiveness of the JTF implementation depends on how well we explain the thing on the community on the ground, you know, on the ground. So yeah, I'd say those two main points, communication and developing the interventions so that they actually work. Thank you.
Brilliant, thank you so much. So we're gonna have a comment from Sander, and I see that we did get a question, which is, does Regio/JTF have any kind of infographic or similar to explain these deadlines better? Today is not the first time I've heard someone from the regions or other JT experts perceiving that such a percentage of contracting/spending needing to be done by the end of 2023. So maybe, Sander, you can also clarify just a little bit on the deadlines when it comes to programming and so on. And then we have 12 minutes left. So after Sander's intervention, we will take questions from the audience. So you can do that either through the Q&A function or by raising your hand, and I will press the allow to talk button. So just for everyone's information. But Sander, please go ahead.
Yes, so first on the question, I mean, I already sent in writing a reply. This is a very, you know, legalistic reply. It takes you to the various parts of the regulations where you can find the explanations. But in terms of infographic, the thing is that what I mentioned about these financial and annual tranches of the finances, this is included in all the different programs. And since it is included in all the different programs, it is also available. We have an open data portal, but we are really working very hard in making all the different kinds of info that we have in our data visible to the broad audience. So you will need to bear a bit with us I think the if you dig deeper into the open data platform, you can always find all of the data. But in terms of having it easily visible and available, not everything is, let's say, there yet. But I will post in a minute in the chat also the link to this open data portal, because what you can, for instance, already see, and this goes back to your question, is where actually the money now goes. So you can really track per member state what kind of investments there are. And then you will see that in various JTF programs, the priority are quite different. So, you know, Ivan explained what they have in terms of innovation, in terms of support to enterprises. But Ida Viruma is not the same as Austria, or it's not the same as the Greek islands, you know, so each individual program is quite specific. What I can say is that more or less half of the JTF allocation goes to the two main priorities that we set out in the beginning, which are on the one hand, reskilling the people and helping them to find new jobs. This is about 3 billion that goes to that. And on the other hand, to economic diversification, which Mr. Krastev mentioned. So these kinds of things to really, like the magnet factory in Estonia, to really offer new economic opportunities in new promising sectors. Around 5 billion goes to that. And the other half goes to more targeted investments linked to the various needs of the JTF regions. We are now that we have all the TJTPs in place, also launching several more analysis to really bring to the surface the commitments that we have, to compare them. This is a little bit the kind of work that Bankwatch has already done as well for the specific member states that you are following. But we are, of course, interested in all the member states. So these kinds of analysis will also be published as soon as we have them. And I'm inviting you as well to the next Just Transition Platform Conference, which will take place on the 25th and 26th of April. But now looking ahead at implementation, a couple of points are very important to DG Regio, and several have already been mentioned. First of all, I really need to say that the implementation of the JTF is one of the absolute priorities of DG Regio this year, for the reasons I already explained. And this also means that communicating about the JTF, as Ivan has said, is very important. And this is important in all member states. So also those which receive only 9 or 23 million of the JTF. We want the JTF to be a success in all the member states. Is very important to us. Second point is that the efficient planning of projects is important because of the stricter deadlines. This is why I think the example of the magnet factory in Ida Viruma, which was in fact the very first JTF project ever to be selected in Europe, why this is such an important example, because it, and perhaps Ivan can explain this more in the remaining time, it has been prepared before the adoption of the program. And this kind of efficient planning of project is something that we need to see in all the JTF regions. Thirdly, the Just Transition Fund is not business as usual. So we really have quite important ambitions in the TJTPs. We need these ambitions to be translated in ambitious projects that keep the same level of ambition. A fourth point is that partnership is for us not something that was important only for the development of the programs and the plans, but also in the implementation. So we want the youth, the trade unions, the social partners, the NGOs to be involved in the implementation as well. And the final point is that we in the Commission will stay close to member states and regions when they implement. There is a range of mechanisms of assistance already available to member states. And we will put extra assistance in place as well. So this is what Miloslava was asking me about. So under the umbrella of the Just Transition Platform, we will launch a call. We are currently preparing it. It will be launched in the next days or a couple of weeks, where anyone in JTF regions can really apply to get extra help, targeted help, needs-based help to implement the plan. So this call will be published very soon on DG Regio's website. So please keep your eye open for that as well. Thanks.
Thank you very much. So we have two questions now. First is from Lorenzo Manca, and it is, has DG Regio any news on how many monitoring committees are already active? Have representatives of the Commission already been appointed for all countries except Bulgaria? And then there is one for Stefan Krastev. which is, would you say that you were sufficiently involved in the drafting and the discussions on the TTTP for your region? So maybe Stefan would like to answer that one first, and then Sander can answer the one from Lorenzo Manca.
We were very sufficiently involved in the drafting of the JTTP, but once again, I cannot say that this is valid probably for all municipalities and all stakeholders. We are very active in this field. We, you know, I'm a member of a working group together with Miloslava, which is, you know, attached to the Commission for the Horizontal Stakeholder Strategy in Bulgaria, next to the Council of Ministers. We have the Consultative Council for the European Green Deal, and the main sub sort of formation of it is the Commission for Energy Transition, which I'm also a member of. So yes, we were very actively involved, and the consultants who drafted the JTTP were of course reaching out for us, but we didn't just sit and wait for them to reach out to us. We were reaching out to them as well, and we were reaching out to other stakeholders in the region and people that we think should be involved. So the short answer is yes.
Wonderful, that's good to hear. Sander.
So yeah, for those who don't know what monitoring committees are, these are the main bodies organized by the managing authorities, by the member states and regions, to decide on how projects are selected and to monitor the implementation of the funding. So in around 9 member states, this will be monitoring committees that are only about JTF, but in the other member states, they are monitoring committees that deal with various funds, because in those cases, the JTF is part of a multi-fund program. What I can say is that the first JTF program was adopted already in June 2022, that was Greece. I know that the very first official JTF monitoring committee met early September in Sweden. In fact, this met one day after the program adoption. But for many other member states, in fact, there had already been shadow monitoring committees, so already meetings taking place before the program was officially adopted. I don't have an official overview of how many meetings have taken place or how many monitoring committees have already met, but in as far as I am aware, I think in the majority of the cases, at least one monitoring committee has already, monitoring committee meeting has already taken place. And indeed, in all of the monitoring committees, there is officially one member of the European Commission. This is always the colleague of the geographical unit dealing with that member state, who is an official member, although without voting power of that committee. But in practice, they have the entire commission behind them. So they consult other services when needed. And very often in the meetings also other colleagues and other commission services participate and take the floor.
Wonderful, thank you very much. It doesn't seem like there are any further questions at the moment. So maybe we can use the last 2 minutes to give the floor to Ivan to add a little bit more info on this battery factory, as per the request of Sander.
Magnets are not batteries.
Ah, indeed.
but it's okay. But anyways, yeah, thanks, Sander, for the nice words. Basically, yeah, what happened was that, as I said, we started with outreach activities already in 2020. So even before we knew exactly what the JTF regulation is going to be, pretty much like we were pretty early with communicating that, hey, something is coming. We're not really sure what it is yet, but it's probably going to address these things. And so you, all of y'all in Ida Viruma region, you should kind of, you know, beware. And so from that, as the regulation got more and more refined, we also have a steering committee specifically for the JTF established on the level of, like, on the national level. So that's one of the important ways of how we disperse information into the different groups, right? So the steering committee is comprised of representatives of the you know, environmental NGOs. We have the oil shale sector actually represented in this committee as well, and you know, the employers, employees, different research institutions, so on and so forth. So that's how we make sure that the information travels. Again, Estonia is a pretty small country. We're pretty digitally apt. So in that sense, the information traveling ease, is that's something that we're just well known for. And I guess this has helped us with reaching out to companies, like the companies that were considering some sort of investments. They were just paying attention to whatever we were communicating. And as the information was being more and more refined, since we didn't do it in such a way that, hey, the TJTP is now published, you guys can take a look at it. No, we've been sort of talking about it as we were developing it, and also with the interventions as well. So we're not keeping it to ourselves until everything is done and then, ta-da, you know, we have a major launch event. But we were sort of communicating. So, for example, the initial information on how we see the investment intervention working was made public in April 2020 or 21. So it was a long time ago. And by then, we already knew that approximately what kind of investments we would like to attract and so on and so forth. So the companies that were in the loop, they got early start. And that's really it. So from our side, all we had to do is just to make sure that the information keeps traveling from us outward. And then the companies who are interested, they could take note and then start preparing their projects. And the Neo factory, the magnet factory, they were just a great example of one of those companies. They were just kind of keeping, you know, their lookout and then staying in touch, visiting our seminars, and that's it. So in that sense, it's again a tribute to, I guess, communication in a sense, like lean startup methodology where you make, you know, the minimal viable product available to the market as soon as you have it, and then you refine as you go. So in that sense, yeah, I would advise everybody else, if you're still in the sort of planning or processing phase, then make your information public as soon as possible, because then you have more input. Your interventions are better. They're more suited for the situation on the ground. And on the other hand, it's already kind of a flag to the businesses that, hey, this is serious. We're actually planning to do this. So you guys should stay, on board. So yeah, this would be my message, I guess, as far as this is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that's a great note to end on. So we are now past the time, and it's time for lunch for most people, I would assume. So I just want to say thank you very, very much to the panelists. Also to everyone that joined us today. I hope it was useful. And just a final note, that to keep your eyes open, because we will be doing these kinds of webinars every month.